Okay, let me see if I can share the screen. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Something written on it? Okay. Thank you very much for the introduction. Thanks to Shine Matthew for inviting me for this talk. So let me just begin right away. Instead of keeping you waiting for more. So the basic idea of the talk is to introduce hyperbolic geometry in complex analysis. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to first define what the hyperbolic metric on the unit disk is. So I'm going to throw a definition at you, which is going to be quite complicated, and then I will explain why do we look at this complicated definition and what is its use in answering questions of complex analysis. Okay, so by this popular notation script D, we'll denote the unit disk, and for every pair of points P and Q in the unit disk, you consider the collection gamma PQ, which is the collection of all piecewise smooth curves joining P and Q. Okay, so this is the just draw a little picture here. Two points P and Q, and you consider all the various curves which join P and Q. And then can you look at this quantity? Integral mod gamma dot t. So piecewise smooth, so the derivative is almost everywhere, they are well defined, and therefore you can integrate gamma dot t mod of gamma dot t divided by gamma t square t. And you infimize over the collection gamma pq. Okay. And call this infimum d height pq. Okay. So this is the hyperbolic distance between p and q on the unit disk. Okay. So they can be checked. This gives a distance or a metric. Is a distance on the unit disk. Okay. So, in other words, D equipped with this D height is a metric space. So, in this talk, I'm going to reserve the word metric for something else. So I will call this a distance space. So I'll just call what is usually called a metric in metric space theory. I will call it distance. I'll use the word distance for this. Metric will be reserved for something a little different. But so as I said, this definition looks somewhat complicated, and one wonders why should one consider the first question to ask is why should one consider this at all, and what is its relevance to complex analysis? So at this moment, let me just pause and ask whether the screen, am I audible again, and whether the screen is visible.
Yes, it's visible.
And I'm audible well, right?
Yes.
Okay. So question. Why consider this distance? So this has a long answer to it. There's a long story behind this. This is, by the way, this hype is a short form for hyperbolic metric. It's also a hyped metric. So D in the first line has to be a proper subset. I see. Let's see where is it. No, this is a notation. So D is the no notation. So let me write it more visibly. Script D, this is notation for unit disk. Notation for disk of radius 1 about the origin. So does that answer your question? Disk of radius 1 centered at the origin. So that's the
I got it.
Okay. So by the way, I am assuming familiarity with complex analysis. So have all of you or most of you taken a course in complex analysis? One course, two course? Are you in your first year of MSc or second year of MSc? Well, I cannot hear you. First year, okay, I see. So have you, so somebody says you have taken a course in first, at least a first course in complex analysis. So at least some of you, I guess, are familiar with this notation, or this is a standard notation. Maybe you've used different notation, but whatever it is, please feel free to stop me and ask me questions. In case for some reason I'm not audible or you are not audible, do write in the chat box. The chat box is not readily visible to me because I'm sharing the screen, but I will check from our time to time once in a while. Okay. Let's see. Yeah. So so instead of the usual Euclidean distance between P and Q, right? If I take two points and look at the straight line joining them, the length of that straight line gives the usual Euclidean distance, right? Instead of you looking at this distance, I have put a different distance, okay, defined in the manner displayed, which I just described a few minutes ago, and I called it the hyperbolic distance. Okay, well and good, I gave it a name, but what is the point of this is the question that we are trying to answer now. This has a long history to it, but I will cut short the history and rather tell you what is the importance of this distance in complex analysis. So answer, there is a long answer to it. It should be skipped. Long answer is skipped. So basically the long answer in short is that people wanted a model of geometry was seeked or was sought in which all Euclidean axioms of Euclidean geometry is satisfied but for the parallel postulate. So the parallel postulate is states that given a straight line and given a point outside it, there is a unique line passing through that point, given point and parallel to it. Okay, so this is the historical reason for considering this hyperbolic metric, in which if you are given a point and a geodesic, which is an analog of a straight line, there are multiple the parallel postulate fails basically. Okay, but this will not be the viewpoint that we shall take. We shall look at the significance of this distance in complex analysis. Okay, so I'll now move on to this. However, the answer that we shall be interested in this is another answer, and the other answer of interest to us is its significance in complex analysis. Okay. So what does the significance in complex analysis mean? What do these words mean really? Okay, okay. Well, these are English words. You can search in the dictionary if you don't happen to know any meaning of one of these words, which is fine. But that's not what we are trying to get towards. What we are trying to get towards is there a question which is about strictly about holomorphic maps? Nothing to do with distances, metrics, nothing whatsoever. I mean, there is no mention of these distance and metrics and so on. Is there a question which after studying a first course in complex analysis, which we can fully understand, but whose answer requires this hyperbolic distance, or it is made easier by considering this hyperbolic distance? Okay, so that's that would be a justification for considering this distance, and that's what we shall do. Okay, so let me briefly put what we shall show. Shall give an example. So the significance of this distance will be shown by an example. Okay, shall show by an example at least. That there is a question, that there are questions about holomorphic mappings or analytic complex analytic mappings. Questions about holomorphic is the same as complex analytic. Some of you would be would call the basic maps and complex analysis as analytic maps. I am more used to the word holomorphic, so I just would like to make the clarification here that complex analytic and holomorphic mean one and the same thing. About holomorphic mappings, which are whose answers, the questions whose answers are made easy by considering by the above distance, by using the above distance. So more precisely, more specifically, here is an example. Okay, more specifically, shall show the following. Here, sample theorem. Suppose F is a holomorphic map, self map of the unit disk. Okay. With the property that its image the closure of the image, so the image lands inside the unit disk, and if you take the closure you get a compact set inside the unit disk. Then F has a unique fixed point. Okay, and the idea of the proof in one line, which will be elaborated much in this talk, is that shall show that the unit disk equipped with this hyperbolic distance is a complete metric space or a complete distance space. Okay, and before I proceed, let me just see if people are following. Let me ask, do you know of a theorem of about self maps of complete metric spaces which guarantees the existence and uniqueness of a fixed point? Yes, no, maybe somewhat you remember, but not fully. So have you taken a course on general topology, metric spaces and so on? Okay. Not very familiar. I see. So is the term metric space familiar to you or not at all? Banach fixed point theorem. Yeah, very good. I see. So in the semester that you are in right now, I think so this Akash Jain answers me this. So you are in the second year or first year? Second year, I see. So only in second year you are taught metric space, is it? Okay, I don't know. Okay, so let's continue nevertheless. So much of the talk will be understandable even if you don't know what a metric space is, but it's not very difficult to define at least. So let me just give you the definition of a metric space. Metric space is any set equipped with a function D. Okay. Okay, let me complete the sentence here and then I will define what a metric space is. Okay, so shall show that the unit disk with the this D hype is a complete metric distance space, and this map F is a strict contraction. Okay, and the map F. Recall, or for those of you who are seeing it for the first time, metric space is a set X equipped with a distance function D from X cross X to positive reals, satisfying the basic axioms of a distance, which the Euclidean distance does satisfy. So dpq is zero if and only if p equal to q. That's the first axiom. Second axiom is symmetry. Distance between p and q is same as distance between q and p. And third is triangle inequality. Okay. P and R, if you have three points P, Q and R, distance between P and R is less than distance between P and Q, and distance between Q and R. Okay, so to emphasize one last time, the question here, which let me put highlight here in orange, is about the existence and uniqueness of a fixed point of a holomorphic self map of the unit disk. From disk to disk, you have a map, and the question is, does it have a fixed point, or is the fixed point unique, and so on. You are given a little hypothesis, your condition that the map satisfies, namely that its image is relatively compact in the unit disk. Okay, and so the question has no mention of any distance whatsoever. It's a purely a question about holomorphic mappings. That it's a question within complex analysis. But the answer is facilitated by in the introduction of a distance, okay, and borrowing a theorem from metric space theory. Okay, so this is the theme of this talk. Okay. So if holomorphic maps are the maps of interest in complex analysis and they are the nice maps to consider in complex analysis, what are the nice maps in metric space theory? Okay, so morphisms in metric space theory. Morphisms. So in group, you have studied groups, rings, and so on, and vector spaces and so on. Every of these category has a the notion of a morphism and isomorphism, right? Morphism basically means a structure preserving map. So if it's a group homomorphism means it it's a map between two groups which such that the group law is respected. Okay, G of A dot G of B is equal to G of AB. Okay, and for vector, similarly for vector spaces, the linear structure is respected. So morphism basically means a structure preserving map, and isomorphism means the map is also 1-to-1. Okay, so it's not the when we say structure preserving, it may not be exactly preserved. For instance, in the case of metric spaces, isomorphisms preserve it exactly, because a general morphism may not be 1-to-1. If you have a map F between two metric spaces X D1 and so X1 D1 and X2 D2, okay, is a morphism. Okay, in the category of metric spaces, if it satisfies, if F satisfies distance in the target X2, the codomain between let's say X1 and X1 tilde. Okay, this is less than or equal to the distance between X1 and X1 tilde. Okay, for all X1 tilde in the, for all pairs of points in the domain metric space X1, the distance is no bigger than the distance that you started off with, and this is if you some know another term called Lipschitz. This is a Lipschitz map with constant Lipschitz constant at most one. Okay, so such a map is you can think of it as a morphism, as a, you know, something loosely speaking analogous to a group homomorphism in the category of groups. And if this map F is 1-1, then the inequality holds in both directions. And if F is 1-1, the inverse also satisfies this. If F is 1-1 and inverse also satisfies such an inequality, then distance between F of X1 and F of okay, I think I goofed up something here. I should say F of X1 and F of X1 tilde. Sorry about this. Okay, so distance between the pair of images of these points X1 and X1 tilde. Okay, so if the distance is exactly the same, if the distance is preserved, okay, if the distance is preserved, then you say that this is an isometric. F is an isometric. Okay, so we will be mostly interested in X1, X2 being the unit disk. Okay, so we don't move out of domains in the complex plane. In particular, in fact, we will just stick to the unit disk. But this is a general definition which is useful to know. Okay, and we are going to connect. We are going to use a theorem from metric basic metric space theory in complex analysis. Okay. So the other question that you would like to ask me is, why is this called the hyperbolic distance? Okay. So first of all, it is not difficult to check that this indeed satisfies these axioms that I wrote down. Okay, so for want of time, I will not spend time on checking these basic axioms for this hyperbolic distance that I wrote down. But so this one can check that this is a metric space or distance space. why call it the hyperbolic distance? Okay, so maybe I will postpone the answer to the naming, the nomenclature of this distance being hyperbolic. Rather, I will focus on why, what is the usefulness of this distance in complex analysis. Okay, I've already mentioned this briefly here. I will now expand upon that. For the usefulness, one looks at, so this is a distance on the unit disk. So let's start with a fundamental result about holomorphic self maps of the unit disk. Okay. So to continue discussing. The significance of the hyperbolic distance in complex analysis, or which means about questions about holomorphic mappings. Let's start. We begin with what the following fundamental result. About holomorphic self maps of the unit disk. So this is called Schwarz lemma. So suppose F is a holomorphic self map of the unit disk, which fixes the origin. So the earlier theorem that I said would be the goal of this talk. Okay, it concludes about the existence of fixed point. In this lemma, we will assume the existence of a fixed point. In fact, we will we'll suppose that the origin is fixed by F. What happens if F has a fixed point? That's the answer that this lemma will give. Okay, then first of all, mod of Fz is less than or equal to mod Z, and there is also a bound on the derivative at the origin, the fixed point, for the point which is fixed by F, namely that it's at most one. And if equality holds, equality holds in either of these, if and only if F is a rotation. In which case, note that F of mod Fz is equal to mod Z for all Z in the unit disk. So if equality holds just for one point, equality holds even for one point, so maybe some of you have seen this, particularly those of you who are in the second year. So I would like to know if that is the case. So let's say Akash Jain answered me that he's from second year. Have you seen Schwarz lemma before? Okay, there's some comment here saying that there are participants from first year, second year, and research scholars and faculty. Okay. In functional analysis, you have seen Schwarz lemma. I see. Possible, but in a complex analysis course, you have not seen the Schwarz lemma with full proof. Okay, let me then in that case discuss a little discuss the Schwarz lemma elaborately. Here's the proof. because f is holomorphic with on the unit disk, first recall that if you have a holomorphic map on a disk, then it is represented by a single power series. Holomorphic maps by definition are functions which are representable locally by convergent power series, but the local will become global here because the domain is a disk. Okay, recall that f has a power series, f is representable. By a single power series. Let's say f of z is a naught plus a one z plus a two z square, and so on. Right. So the first term here, the constant term here, a zero is zero because f of zero is given to be zero. Okay. So in other words, the Taylor expansion or the power series expansion starts with z, and z is a common factor for all the terms here. So I can pull out the z and write this as z times g of z. Okay. So z is a common factor. And therefore can write, which means we can rewrite f as z times g of z, where g of z is whatever you comes out by pulling out the z. So in other words, g of z, another way of saying where g of z is f of z divided by z. And this division does not make sense if z is the origin. So what should I do? Z is not zero. If z is zero, then you let it to be equal to f prime z, okay, which is what is a one. Okay. So that if you pull out the z, the first term will be a one, but a one is f prime z, right? The derivative of f at the origin, and this is also a holomorphic map, holomorphic function or map, whatever you want to call. Okay. Well and good. What are the hypotheses to us given to us? F is a map, self map from the unit disk to itself. So which means we are already given in some sense the first inequality, but not in as strong a form as this, but rather in the form that f of mod f z. So this means mod f z is less than one. Or strictly less than one, in fact, for all z in the unit disk, and we want to improve this inequality to mod f z is less than mod z. So that's what this lemma is telling us. But more geometrically, already there is some geometric content very visible here. If you recall that modulus gives nothing but the distance of the point to the origin, then the first conclusion here is that the distance of the f to the image of any point to the origin under the action of the mapping, right? The distance does not increase. Distance of f of z to the origin is no more than the distance of z to the origin. Okay, so this already says that there is a more geometrical way of looking at the Schwarz lemma than just writing mod f z and playing around with inequalities and factorizations as I'm going to do in the proof. Okay, so there's more to it. But first, let's finish off the standard proof, which I'm recalling here. Okay. So g of z is also a holomorphic function, and by hypothesis, mod f z is less than one implies that if you use the fact that f is a holomorphic self map, takes unit disk into the unit disk, then what does it say about g? It's less than one by mod z. Okay, so this is what you have, but you can do better. Why is that? Because if we use a fundamental estimate about holomorphic mapping, so fundamental inequality that holomorphic mapping satisfies. fundamental result inequality. Inequality result. What is that? Namely, maximum principle. Let me make these words more clearer by so let's consider okay so what we will do is we will show this inequality that we want to show point by point. Okay, so you fix a point z0 in the unit disk. Before we proceed ahead, first you fix a point z0. Fix any pick any point and fix it. Fix attention on that. Let's say little r is the modulus of z0. Okay. So here is your disk origin z0. And this is the distance. It is r. Okay. Okay. And you consider the restriction. Of f, g, etc. Okay, f and g to disk of radius r, which I will denote by d sub r. Okay. So this is disk of radius r centered at the origin. See, we are given f is a holomorphic map in the unit disk, but we don't know whether it extends continuously to the boundary. So we can't apply maximum principle straight away. To f on the unit disk. I mean, okay, we know that the local maxima are not attained by any holomorphic map. That much we can say, unless it's a constant. But we cannot say that the maximum is attained on the boundary unless we know that f is continuous up to the boundary, right? That is why we would like to fix attention on disks of smaller radius. So let's see. So maybe I'll draw a better picture here. So you could take a disk of radius r or take a disk of bigger radius also, slightly bigger radius. So I'll just draw the slightly bigger radius disk here. Okay, so supposed to be a disk, though it may not my drawing may not be very good. Okay, so then these restrictions are continuous on the closed disk and holomorphic on the interior, and therefore maximum is attained finite is not so great because f is already given to be bounded by 1. So the main point is it's attained on the boundary. And one can also say that the maximum of g is also attained on the boundary. Okay. And more importantly, so let's go back to this inequality here. Right. So mod g of z. Right. Is less than or equal to attained on this boundary, and so this is equal to, let's write here, right? F is at most 1, and mod z now is on the boundary, right? On the boundary, or z on the boundary. This is R, okay? So the red thing is the disk of radius R, d sub R. So this is less than one, less than or equal to 1 by R. Okay, so this this requires that mod z is equal to R. Okay, so on the boundary this is on, but then the same inequality holds in the interior as well because of the maximum principle. Same this inequality holds. Inequality persists in the interior as well by maximum principle. Okay, so what does it mean? What do these words persist in the interior as well mean? It means that it holds for all z in so mod fz is less than z by R, right? For all z, not only in the boundary but on the closed disk. Okay, so you could do this in two ways. You could actually fix a radius R. Here you fixed a point z naught. So you could do this in two ways. You could fix a radius R, it will go through and give you this maximum principle based argument will go through and it will give you this conclusion which I am boxing. Okay, alternatively you could fix a point z naught as I did, and you this inequality is then valid for all the possible radius which are bigger than mod z naught. Okay, so you need not exactly take R equal to mod z naught, you can take R bigger than mod z naught. Okay, so the same argument holds if you take a radius, any radius R bigger than or equal to z naught. So then so you can, for any fixed z naught you can vary radius, vary this radius from mod z naught to 1. Okay, so in particular you can let the radius R go to 1. So in particular now you can let R go to 1 to get this first inequality. Okay, to get part one of the Schwarz lemma. Okay, for the second assertion all you have to do is rewrite the first one. Okay, rewriting this part one, we have mod fz by z is less than 1, or this is the same as, you rewrite this a little bit more elaborately, even if this rewriting is trivial, let's do it by introducing f of 0 and 0, subtracting out 0 in the numerator and denominator, and recalling that f of 0 equal to 0. You have to use that hypothesis somewhere, right? So here it's getting used, and this is less than or equal to 1 for all z in the disk, which means if I let z go to zero, of the quantity which appears inside the modulus sign, that's the derivative, right? So by taking limits, as z approaches the origin, we conclude that f prime 0 is at most 1. Okay, and by the way, we use the maximum principle somewhere, and according to which there are two ways of looking at the maximum principle. If you have a holomorphic function on a domain which is not necessarily known to be extending continuously to the boundary, then you would say that the map f does not have any local maximum. Okay, unless here the inequalities, all the inequalities that we are talking about, which is involved in the definition of maximum, are assumed to be non-strict inequalities. Okay, if it is strict, I will specifically spell it out. So The only way in which this we could say that there is a local maximum is that the function become a constant. Okay, so okay, since I'm running short of time, let me just skip that. So when s becomes a constant, here it will become the inequality. If the if let's say the inequality here becomes an equality, then that means f prime 0 is a constant of size 1, right? And if f prime 0 is constant, then f must be a rotation, right? So I'll just skip that part, cut short that part, and we will proceed ahead. Okay, so one knows that what are all, so one holomorphic maps. So rotations are, so we said if equality holds in one of these, then the map F is a rotation. But and rotation is a biholomorphic map of the unit disk. It means it's a bijective holomorphic self map of the unit disk. What are all the one-to-one holomorphic mappings, bijective holomorphic mappings? Well, they are of the form rotations. Answer is they are all of the form. So what I'm doing here is application of the Schwarz lemma. Application of the Schwarz lemma to determining automorphisms of the unit disk. So they are all of the form z going to g to the I theta times z minus some fixed point zeta by 1 minus zeta bar z. Okay, so in other words, there exists every automorphism is of the form z going to an expression of this kind. Okay, so in fact, after some people write this also written as, after pulling out a minus sign, some people focus on this expression zeta minus z divided by, so zeta is where theta is some particular real number and zeta is also a point on the unit disk, some fixed point. Okay, and some people look at this expression, and we will call this, give this a name, so call this is equal to phi zeta of z. So then that means, so with this notation, the point is that every automorphism is the composition of a rotation with a map of the of this kind. Okay, because minus 1 z going to minus 1, it's a minus z, right? If I pull out the minus here, then it's rotation by 180 degrees. Okay, so that's also a rotation. So it's basically a composition of rotation with a map of with one of the with phi zeta of z for some fixed zeta and z. Tell you. Okay. So two questions here. What is the proof of this result? That's one. And the other is how did one think of this? Okay. How did one guess that these are the automorphisms and these are all the automorphisms? Okay. So let me briefly indicate answers to these questions. First, let me give you the proofs that these are all the automorphisms. And first of all, that these are automorphisms. Okay. So proof in two steps. Step one is each phi zeta is an automorphism. Okay, and the proof of this proof of this claim as follows. Certainly this is a these are fractional linear maps or Mobius transformations, as you may first course in complex analysis. These are just ratio of two linear polynomials, so these are linear fractional transformations. The denominator vanishes when 1 minus zeta bar z equal to 0, or in other words z equal to 1 by zeta bar, right? So if you look at draw a picture, origin zeta, where is 1 by zeta bar located? It is located on the same line passing through the origin and zeta, but so these are inverse points. So if zeta is very close to the arc of the unit circle here, the 1 by zeta bar will be here. If zeta is somewhere near the origin, then 1 by zeta bar would be near infinity, right? So let me just mark somewhere here 1 by zeta bar. So zeta and zeta bar are sort of images of each other under reflection in the unit circle. Okay. So the other question that I was telling you about how did one think of these maps is that from your basic course in one variable course in one variable complex analysis, you would know that you would have studied under the topic of stereographic projections and the adjoining of a point at infinity, that you could lines and circles could essentially be considered in one bag. Okay. So if you look at Mobius transformations, you cannot say that they send lines to lines, but you can say that they send every line or a circle to a circle or a line. Okay, it cannot send it to a parabola or a hyperbola. Okay. So if you know that, if you look for rotations are automorphisms which fix the origin, right? So if you ask for which are there any automorphisms of the unit disk which take the origin somewhere else? Okay. So let me put in a small box here motivation behind PZ. So rotations, so first of all recall that rotations fix the origin, and the question is how to find or guess self maps of bijective self maps of the unit disk which send origin somewhere else. Sends origin to some other point zeta. Okay. So if you look at this map phi zeta, what does it do to the origin? If you put z equal to 0, I think you should say here, first of all, trivial observations that should be made, trivial but nevertheless noteworthy observations, that phi zeta of 0 is z, and phi zeta of zeta itself, if you put zeta here, then it is 0, right? So in other words, it interchanges origin and zeta. So this map phi zeta interchanges origin and zeta, okay? But here, what we are trying to do is we assume that we don't know the map phi zeta as yet, and we are trying to see if we can guess this map somehow. Okay, so maybe I don't know if I should let the answer out right now, or if I should wait for a few moments for you to guess. let's see what would be a good way of doing this. Okay, maybe I'll say a few words. If you want a map which sends, so this map sends origin to zeta, or another way of saying this is send some other point, instead of, the map should be a map such that it does not fix the origin. Okay, so it takes some other point zeta to the origin. So how to guess of bijective self map of the unit disk which sends some fixed point zeta, some given point zeta to the origin. Okay, let's phrase the question like that, other than this. So zeta is given to you. Somebody gives you a zeta and asks if you can find a holomorphic bijective self map of the unit disk which sends zeta to the origin. Well, if it sends zeta to the origin, so zeta is here. I've already marked zeta on the figure, so let me not mark one more zeta. So if it sends zeta to the origin, then the corresponding point 1 by zeta bar, if you are trying for a linear fractional transformation, which by the way is a 1-to-1 map of the Riemann sphere, okay, that goes to infinity. The reason we are considering Riemann sphere is because there is an infinity there. Infinity is not in the complex plane. So you want a map. So if you want to start trying simple maps, okay, apart from a rotation, right? We don't want to try rotation which fixes origin. Then you would be like one simple class of maps to consider is linear fractional transformation, which start with linear transformations, LFTs, which send zeta to the origin and one by zeta bar to infinity. Okay, so if you want such a map, then you would be led to considering maps of this form. So that's with those few words, I will now proceed with the rigorous proof. Okay. So what you do is you look at the mod phi of zeta, phi zeta of zeta, right? Which is zeta minus z, 1 bar minus zeta bar. This can also be noticed that at the boundary, okay. First notice for z in the boundary, which means mod z is 1, right? So if I look at this quantity, it is 1 by z bar, that's modulus 1. So it doesn't matter whether I put it there or not, but I will do this trick of multiplying this given quantity by 1 by z bar. With this, what happens is that this whole thing is equal to zeta minus z divided by zeta bar minus, okay, z bar minus zeta bar times mod z square, right? Just multiply this z bar times 1 z bar and z mod z square. Z bar is mod z square, and therefore this is, if you look at this now, okay, numerator is zeta minus z, denominator is zeta bar, right, z bar minus so much, right? Because mod z square is 1, z is in the boundary, right? So therefore what I've done is that on the boundary this modulus is equal to the modulus of zeta minus z divided by zeta bar minus z bar. So this denominator is just the conjugate of the numerator, okay. What can you say about their modulus? They must be equal. So it must be the ratio is 1. Okay. So on the boundary, in other words, the upshot of this, or this, is that phi zeta, which is just a Mobius transformation, in particular, this is the pole or the singularity of this Mobius transformation or linear fraction transformation, is outside, well outside the unit disk, the closed unit disk, and it takes the boundary to the boundary. Okay. Therefore, by maximum principle, what can you conclude? You can say that phi zeta of z is at most one for all z in the unit test. Okay, which means in particular that phi zeta maps the interior of the unit test to itself. So instead of brute force checking, the map is given to you by an explicit expression. So one can actually brute force check that phi zeta mod of phi zeta of z is less than 1 for every z less than 1. Okay, instead of looking at for mod z less than 1, what I have done is look at the expression for mod z equal to 1, and then just use the maximum principle and concluded that this inequality persists in the inside, which means that phi zeta maps the unit disk into itself. Okay, so this shows showing that phi zeta is a holomorphic set map of the unit disk. Okay. Okay, also notice the following. Also note the following thing happens. Okay, maybe I will skip this part because again there's a lot of things which I want to do beyond the first course in complex analysis. These are usually part of the first course in complex analysis. So I will just say that you check. Also check that phi zeta composed with phi zeta itself. If you compose phi zeta with itself, you get identity. Okay. So which means phi zeta is self inverse. So it's bijective. It shows bijective, and it's also inverse of the self inverse map. Okay, is inverse of itself. Okay. incidentally, okay, you may reason why this is true. Instead of checking brute force again, one can actually instead of checking by hand again, since phi zeta is given by an explicit expression, one can always check whether it is 1 to 1 by hand, but one can use the Schwarz lemma. So here's the application of Schwarz lemma. Okay. So for this, what you need to do is so phi zeta is a map from the unit disk to itself. It does not satisfy the hypothesis of the Schwarz lemma that we wrote down, namely that it fixed the origin. Okay, but on the other hand, if you look at phi zeta composed with phi zeta, okay, note that if look at the map psi zeta. If psi zeta equal to phi zeta composed with itself, okay, then what can you say about psi zeta of the origin? Right, it is phi zeta of phi zeta of zero, which means phi zeta of zeta, which is zero. Right, so psi zeta fixes the origin, and you can apply the Schwarz lemma to it. If you want to conclude that by using the Schwarz lemma that the map is 1-1, okay, and it's the identity map, in fact, what should you do? You should look at the you should show that the one of the inequalities in the Schwarz lemma is turns into an equality. I hope you remember the Schwarz lemma, right? So we will show that the derivative at the origin is 1. So if you want to compute the compute derivative of psi zeta at the origin. So in order to do this, you need to by chain rule. In order to do this, What you need to do is compute the derivative of phi zeta, because psi zeta is defined in terms of phi zeta. You compute the derivative of phi zeta. So phi zeta of z, again recall, this is zeta minus z divided by 1 minus zeta bar z. So therefore, phi zeta prime z, which is by the chain rule, right? 1 minus zeta bar z square, okay? Derivative of the denominator with respect to z, which is minus zeta bar, times, first let me just keep the denominator as it is, and differentiate the numerator, which is, it gives you a minus 1, minus minus zeta bar times zeta minus z. So what is that? Minus 1 plus zeta bar z plus mod zeta square, right, plus minus zeta bar z. So this factor zeta bar z cancels, and it leaves you with this expression, mod zeta square minus 1 divided by 1 minus zeta bar z. So if you so this is the expression for the derivative of phi zeta. Okay, so at the origin, phi zeta prime at the origin, okay, is mod zeta square minus 1. So you recall that we are calculating psi zeta prime at 0. Psi zeta prime at the origin is equal to which is d by write it so elaborately. Phi zeta prime at zeta by chain rule is so much, right? So at you need this at two points, at z equal to 0 and at z equal to zeta, the derivative phi zeta prime, phi zeta prime at zeta, right? That is mod zeta square minus 1 divided by 1 minus mod zeta square whole square, okay, which is minus 1 divided by 1 minus mod zeta square. So in other words, if you multiply these two out, if I remove the minus sign here, this would be 1 by mod zeta square minus 1. And we just calculated here that this is mod zeta square minus 1. Okay. So which means the derivative of psi at the origin is 1, and by the Schwarz lemma you conclude that this is identity. So the valid, so this shows that if you compose phi zeta with itself, you get the identity map. So it's a self-inverse mapping. Okay, and then again apply the Schwarz lemma. So if G is a map from the unit disk to itself, with which is an automorphism, some arbitrary automorphism, so if it's an arbitrary automorphism, it need not fix the origin. It takes the origin somewhere, say g of 0 equal to zeta. Okay, consider the map phi zeta. Okay, so zeta is equal to g of 0. Consider the map capital F of z, which is defined of first let me map F from the unit disk to itself, obtained by composing these maps g and phi zeta. So that means, what is this g phi zeta of g of z, let's say. Okay. So what does this map F do to zeta? G sends zeta to the origin. G sends origin to zeta. Phi zeta takes zeta to origin, so this fixes the origin. So note that F fixes the origin. Okay, So in other words, you are in the setting of Schwarz lemma. You can apply Schwarz lemma to capital F, and then you, what do you get? You get mod F prime 0 by Schwarz lemma. Okay. You can also look at the inverse. Okay, so G is an automorphism, which means it's 1-to-1. So what is the inverse of this map? P zeta composed with G. It is G inverse composed with phi zeta inverse. Phi zeta inverse is phi zeta itself, as we just saw a few moments ago. So you can apply this same argument to G inverse composed with phi zeta inverse, right? Inverse map. This is at most one. And by applying the same argument, to F inverse, we get the other way around inequality, and use the chain rule. Okay, the relation between the derivative of the inverse and the inverse of the derivative. This is at most less greater or equal to one. In particular, both of these will say that mod F prime zero is equal to one. Okay, and then conclude that F must be a rotation. So in other words, G, so that is by Schwarz lemma again, F must be a rotation. So if capital F is a rotation, what is this G? G equal to F composed with phi zeta inverse, which is F times phi zeta, right? So a rotation composed with phi zeta. So in other words, we started off with an arbitrary automorphism. By applying the Schwarz lemma, we have concluded that the automorphism must have a specific form, namely a rotation composed with phi zeta. So we have proved the fact that every automorphism of the unit disk is of the form rotation composed with. This answer has now been done. Okay. Okay. So that was an application of the Schwarz lemma. As I said, Schwarz lemma can be looked at geometrically as follows. Okay. The question: so the Schwarz lemma assumes Schwarz lemma assumes that the origin is fixed. Can we drop the assumption that that the origin is fixed be dropped in the Schwarz lemma? Okay, well, you can drop it provided you are allowed, you are willing to accept a slightly different statement. Okay, so to do this, what you do is, suppose now G is a map, holomorphic map of the unit disk, which is not necessarily an automorphism. So a little while ago we took G to be an automorphism. Now we just take G to be an arbitrary holomorphic self map of the unit disk, which need not fix the origin or need not be an automorphism. Okay, then notice that if G sends the origin to zeta, notation, consider the map again, F of z, which is equal to phi zeta composed with g. Okay, again, since phi zeta sends zeta to the origin, this composed map fixes the origin. Fixes the origin and is a holomorphic self map of the unit disk. therefore can apply Schwarz lemma. To F, okay. So if you apply Schwarz lemma to F, doing this, transforms the inequalities in the Schwarz lemma into the following form: mod f z less than z, right? For instance, in the old Schwarz lemma, to the following form. Which form? Well, F composed with phi zeta, right? So it will appear like this. Okay. So what I want to do is the following. Before I write down the form, let me tell you. Let me draw a picture here. So G is a map, arbitrary holomorphic map, general holomorphic map. Okay. And let's say P and Q are two points here. Arbitrary points. So G of P and G of Q are here. Okay. So this little trick of composing with the automorphism phi zeta, it brings any point to the origin, any given point to the origin. So what you can do is if you consider this map. PQ, okay, PQ inverse, which is PQ, composed with F, composed with G, okay, composed with PQ, PP. So if you consider this map, what it will do to the origin is it takes it to P. P is taken to G of P, okay, and I think I put G of P here. And if you look at G of P inverse, it is taken to the origin. So actually, I would say, yeah, don't apply the Schwarz lemma to this map capital F here. Rather, you apply it to this map. Okay. Little change. So I will skip a few details here since it's already 12:20. We get the following inequality: G of P minus G of Q divided by 1 minus G of P bar G of Q is less than or equal to P minus Q divided by 1 minus P bar Q for all pairs of points P and Q in the unit disk. So this is called the Schwarz-Pick inequality. Schwarz-Pick inequality or lemma. And if the inequality becomes an equality for one pair of points, it becomes an equality for all pairs of points because of the Schwarz lemma conclusion earlier. namely that if inequality, one of the inequalities, mod of z less than or equal to mod z, it holds as an equality for one point, then the inequality is actually an equality for all points. Okay, and if it becomes an equality, then G is an automorphism. Okay, Okay. So it's not difficult to guess that this would be the kind of inequality that you would get by applying the Schwarz lemma and composing, pre-composing and post-composing with automorphisms to relax the assumption that the origin is fixed by the map. Okay. If you don't want the origin to be fixed, then what would you, if you don't know that the origin is fixed by the mapping, then what would you do? You would pre-compose and post-compose with suitable maps so that you bring the arbitrary given pair of given points to the origin. So that's what we have done here, and then apply the Schwarz lemma to the composite map, which fixes the origin, and rewritten the whatever the inequality that Schwarz lemma would give us. Okay, it turns out that the hyperbolic distance that I wrote down initially is essentially given in terms of this expression. Okay, more precisely, turns out that if you define distance dpq as mod p minus q divided by 1 minus p bar q, this is actually a distance function. Actually a distance function on the unit disk. Okay. And moreover, more importantly, it's a routine to check the triangle inequality and so on, which I will skip for want of time, but emphasis on an important point which is relevant for complex analysis, namely that if you have this inequality, tells us the inequality that is Schwarz-Pick lemma can be rephrased in these geometric terms as saying that distance between g of p and g of q is less than or equal to distance between p and q for all pairs of points. Okay, so in other words, every holomorphic map, when you equip the unit disk with this new metric, becomes a morphism in the sense that we described towards the beginning of the talk, right? It's a morphism in the category of metric spaces, and if G is an automorphism, then it's an isometric. Isometry of the metric space D equipped with this distance D. I will put a capital M below to denote the name that it has. It's called the Mobius distance. This is not called the hyperbolic distance. This is called the Mobius distance. Okay, but there are other reasons why one would consider some other distances than this Mobius distance. This is not the only distance such which makes holomorphic maps a morphism and automorphisms into isometries. Okay, for instance, the Poincaré distance, the hyperbolic distance, the hyperbolic distance, oh, just a second, I'm writing on the wrong page. Can be expressed in terms of this Mobius distance. Plus dmpq divided by 1 minus dmpq. Okay, so it has this expression. How does this expression come about, and why? More, it's not difficult to find many sources to read up that. But let me just briefly mention why one considers this rather than the Mobius distance. Okay, If you know some basic differential geometry, you would know that given an infinitesimal metric, one can integrate the infinitesimal metric along curves to get a distance. This Mobius distance is not obtainable so, but the hyperbolic distance can be obtained like that. Okay, this is also called the Poincaré distance. Okay, let me motivate this a little further. In this derivation here, the Schwarzschild lemma, we only used one of the inequalities in the Schwarzschild lemma, namely mod f z is less than mod z, right? What about the other inequality, mod f prime 0 less than or equal to 1? Okay, in fact, let's just start with this Schwarzschild lemma inequality. Leave aside these distance business for a moment. Rewrite this Schwarzschild inequality as follows. Bring the factor p minus q to the denominator on the left and transpose this term, this denominator, to the numerator on the right. Okay, so if you do this, what will you get? Right, and then let p go to q. What do you get? You get g prime q is less than or equal to 1 minus g q square divided by 1 minus mod q square. Correct. So in other words, if I rewrite this again, mod g prime q. Okay, let me learn. Let me put this in general terms. Theorem. This is also Schwarzschild lemma. Okay. For every holomorphic self map of the unit disk, we have mod f prime q is replaced by z and g is replaced by f. Okay. Okay, so if you recall the beginning of the talk here, this expression 1 by 1 minus mod z square, okay, that's the kind of expression that appears in this quantity that I wrote. Okay, so basically you're integrating the density 1 by 1 minus mod z square on this curve gamma. Okay. So this gives rise to the so if rho of z equal to 1 minus mod z square, then rho is a density function for a metric, whatever that means, for a conformal metric. Okay, which on the unit disk, okay, as defined in the beginning of the talk. Okay, so you can ignore these words at the moment, and just note that since we have run out of time a bit, if you define the Poincaré metric not by the way in which I started out, but rather just by this expression log of 1 plus dm by 1 minus dm, because dm itself is invariant under biholomorphic mappings or conformal mappings, as it's called, as some people call it, this expression is also invariant under holomorphic mappings. Okay, so d height is also an invariant metric. invariant distance. Okay, so I will just conclude the talk by doing the following. By answering the question that I initially said, right? Supposing you have a holomorphic self map of the unit disk with f of d, the image being relatively compact in the disk, then f has a unique fixed point. Okay. So one can use this expression to check. So we have an explicit expression for the hyperbolic distance, right? Between z and w is log of 1 plus phi z w divided by 1 minus phi z w. Okay. So this distance is, you can look at what happens if you take a Cauchy sequence. Okay, in the Euclidean metric, whether it's Euclidean Cauchy in this distance, and if you just take a Cauchy sequence which is Cauchy with respect to this distance, whether it will converge to a particular point in the unit disk itself. Okay, so it's the answers are as follows. If you the first answer is no, first question. Second question, if you take a Cauchy sequence with respect to this distance, it turns out that it you can show that it's, first of all, it's a bounded sequence. Therefore, it will have a convergent subsequence, and that limit point is actually a full limit point for the sequence. Okay, so in other words, every Cauchy sequence in this distance is convergent, and hence the your unit disk equipped with this hyperbolic distance is a complete metric space. Okay, once it is a complete metric space, then you can use this Banach fixed point theorem that somebody said, or Banach contraction principle, to prove this result. Okay, so let me quickly outline the proof of this. So f is given to us. Consider the map. So f is relatively compact, right? So here is the unit disk. F of d is like this. Here is the origin. Origin could be even outside the image, but you can trap it inside another disk because it's relatively compact. You can find a disk of some size which entirely contains this, okay, and then there is a minimum gap between the image, minimum distance of the image, points in the image, okay, and the boundary. Okay, so I will call the minimum distance as 2 epsilon for convenience. Instead of epsilon, some epsilon distance, I'll just call it 2 epsilon, and then I will consider the map g of z, which is defined as f of z plus epsilon times f of z minus f of z. So if I do this, so this is basically another way of writing this is 1 plus epsilon times f of z minus epsilon times f prime f of z. So this, if you calculate the derivative of this map, what is it? 1 plus epsilon times f prime z minus derivative of a constant, epsilon times f of z naught. Z naught is a fixed point, so it's constant. Z naught, you fix any z. Fix any z naught and consider this map. Fix any z naught in the unit disk. Okay? Sorry. Fix any z naught in the unit disk. And consider the map G defined as follows. This is a constant, so its derivative is zero, and this implies that the derivative in particular at the origin, or rather at z naught is the fixed point, so at z naught, you apply the Schwarzschild lemma to the derivative at this derivative, according to which, notice that g is also a self map of the unit disk. Before all this, you first note, so this is one thing, one observation. One observation two is, you look at more importantly, look at, note that what is mod g of z? It's less than or equal to 1 plus epsilon times mod f z, right? Use the first expression rather. Let's call this star, okay, u star using star, we get mod g of z is less than mod f of z plus epsilon times mod f of z minus f of z now. Okay, but this quantity f mod f is a holomorphic self-map of the unit disk. So mod, this is less than by triangle inequality mod f z plus mod f z naught, which is less than 2. Okay, so that's why I said 2 epsilon. Okay. So what can you and what about mod f z naught? Okay, all the image points are bounded here. Okay, so it is within the disk of radius 2 epsilon. Okay, so in other words, mod f z mod f of z is less than 1 minus 2 epsilon. F, because f is relatively compact, you can not only say that mod f z is less than 1, you can actually say that it is strictly less than 1 in the sense that it is less than 1 minus some positive constant. So 1 minus 2 epsilon in this case here. And this is the second fact term here is bounded by 2 epsilon. So 1 minus 2 epsilon plus 2 epsilon, which means mod g is bounded above by 1, which means g is a holomorphic self map of the unit disk, which means, and you can apply the Schwarzschild lemma to this. What do you get by applying Schwarzschild? Schwarzschild tells you, it gives you a bound on the derivative, not necessarily at the origin, at any point, right? Schwarzschild lemma gives you a bound on the derivative, but the Schwarzschild was to set that right. It would not only give you a bound on the derivative at the origin, but at any point it would give you. And according to that, mod g prime z naught, according to the Schwarzschild lemma, 1 minus g z naught square is less than 1 minus mod z naught square. Okay, this is what the Schwarzschild lemma is, right? So this would give you what is the expression for the derivative that we calculated, 1 plus epsilon times f prime z. Okay. One plus epsilon times f prime z naught divided by 1 minus 1 plus g of z naught. So g of z naught is, what is g of z naught? If you plug in z naught here, the second term becomes 0. So that is same as f of z naught. Okay. So 1 minus f of z naught is less than or equal to 1 by 1 minus. Okay, so you rewrite this, take the 1 plus epsilon to the right hand side. So this will give you the same Schwarzschild inequality. The Schwarzschild inequality is this term bounded above by 1 minus 1 minus mod z naught square, but with a factor before it, 1 by 1 plus epsilon. Okay. So epsilon is strictly positive, so which means you are dividing 1 by a number which is bigger than 1. Okay, so which means this constant is strictly less than 1. Okay, so you've got an improved bound on the Schwarzschild lemma, and if you integrate this along curves joining a given pair of points p and q, so this is for any fixed point z naught, you can do this. So which means you can do this for all z naught. Okay, so if you integrate this along curves, you essentially get the fact that the hyperbolic distance between f of p and f of q for given any pair of, so gamma is a curve joining p and q. Okay. You get the fact that this is less than or equal to 1 by 1 plus epsilon times hyperbolic distance between p and q. So this is a factor which is strictly less than 1, right? So according to this theorem that you said some of you are familiar with from metric space theory, that if you have a self map of a metric, complete metric space, which is a strict contraction in the sense that it satisfies this inequality with a constant strictly less than 1, then the map must have a unique fixed point. Okay, so by that fact we conclude that this map map f with a relatively compact image in the unit disk has a unique fixed point. Okay, so that is the application of this hyperbolic metric to a question purely about holomorphic maps. on the unit. So with this, I will stop.